if we really believe the good news of the gospel, that it's what the angel said, it's a good news, a great joy that should be for all the people. How mean am I to not tell someone that's never heard?
Thank you so much for watching. You know, as a preacher, I can live on a good compliment for like 3 or 4 months. But I would love for you to like, share, comment on our channel. I think it's going to help not only you, but many, many other people. We're going to have a lot of fun on this channel, but also we're going to go really, really deep. Thank you for connecting with us.
He stands 6'3", the living legend, Tim Tebow.
Tim, thank you. Thank you. Please have a seat.
Tim, it's great to have you here, my man. But Tim, listen, man, tell us a little bit about your life, and specifically because obviously you're a world-class athlete, but your main love is a man, a person called Jesus Christ. I want to hear about how you met him.
Well, I got to grow up in a wonderful family. I was born in the Philippines to missionary parents, and we moved back to the States when I was 5, and we traveled back and forth. And I got exposed to King Jesus at an early age, like all the time. We would go to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, definitely hit a couple Bible studies.
And you're Southern Baptist, right?
Yes. So that means that it's even more Bible studies.
Exactly.
Like all the time. And all the time, my dad would say, "Hey, Timmy, would you like to say yes to Jesus?" Coming off of an invitation or coming off of a pastor or a preacher or a missionary or hearing even my dad talk. And my dad would finish the sermon and say, "Hey, you heard me talking about Jesus. Would you like to say yes to him?" And over again, I would say, "Nah, Dad, I'm good. Over and over and over again until one night I was lying in my bed and I knew that I wasn't good. And I got up early and I ran to go see my mom and I grabbed my mom and I said, "Mom, I gotta ask Jesus to come into my heart." And she said, "Okay, let me go get your father." And I said, "No, Mom, we don't have time." I was pretty intense as a young boy too. But my mom got it. She knew the urgency that was on my heart. She said, "Okay." She got down on her knees, and I got down on my knees. And right there on the west side of Jacksonville, Florida, I asked Jesus to come into my heart. And he did.
Tim, you know, a lot of people are like, "Wow, Tim's intense, man. He's competitive." Well, what does the Bible say? God says, "I'll have no other gods before me." So our God is a competitive God. I don't know if we understand the implications totally of that. God knows if we worship anything else, especially ourselves, we're going to be gravely disappointed. I want to hear about competition because some are like, "Man, I can't be an alpha male or I can't be aggressive being a Christian." I want to hear that.
Yeah, I grew up nth degree competitive. The baby of 5, I loved to compete. I loved to win, and I hated to lose a lot more. And I'm so grateful that my parents didn't try to change me, because there was a lot of people, especially in the church, mostly in the church, that were, "You're way too competitive." Like, And honestly, we don't even know that you love the Lord, you know, like you care. You're going to play a game on Sunday afternoon. Like, how could you?
Yes.
Like a lot over and over again. I'm so grateful that my parents didn't try to change me. They just tried to steer me. They thought, "Okay, you're so competitive and you're doing it for a game and you're doing it for your pride and you're doing it because you want to win in all of this. But what if we just steer you into where you're competing for eternal rewards. You're competing for things that really matter. Yes. You're competing to get to as many hurting people as possible. You're competing for all those things. I'm just as competitive, if not more competitive now than I ever was in sports. It's just for a different purpose, a more important purpose. One of the things that I'm so grateful that my parents did was that when we said yes to Jesus and accepted that free gift that he offers to each and every one of us, that's our spiritual birthday.
Mm-hmm.
And my parents celebrated our spiritual birthday more than they ever celebrated our earthly birthday.
I love that.
And that day, we never had a lot growing up. We're a missionary family and five kids, and like you just learn to compete just to get food off of the table, all right? But they splurged, and we went to Epcot, drove to Orlando, Florida, because they wanted me to remember the most important decision of my life. And still to this day, my mom will send me, if she's not with me, a gift or a text or a message on my spiritual birthday, always emphasizing how much more important it is than any other decision
right.
of my life.
That's right. And Tim, okay, that is the most important decision, knowing Christ. Also, too, you're such an engaging personality. Obviously, your best friends are believers, but you know, a lot of people, you have a kaleidoscopic range of people from all walks of life, many of whom don't know the Lord. Some have everything from a worldly perspective. Others don't have much. How have you been able to navigate your relationships through your life as you've lived this out?
And a few years ago, I was really convicted about it. Why so many times when I could have shared with people, when I had the chances, the opportunities, the platforms to do it, why so many times would I not? Have I not? I thought, well, is it because I don't really believe the gospel? Or do I just not love people enough? You see, because if we really believe the good news of the gospel, that it's what the angel said, it's a good news, a great joy that should be for all the people, and that we really believe that it's a God that loves you so much that sent his son on the greatest love story rescue mission of all time, and it counts for you. How mean am I to not tell someone that's never heard? How mean am I to not say something? You know, so many times I could mask it in the excuse of, well, you know, I really want to be liked. I'm a people pleaser. I'm the baby of five, and I always wanted to be liked by my friends and family. Shoot, I want you to like me. Appreciate you. But see, there's a difference between like and love.
Yes.
When I say I want to be liked, it's because it's about me. But when I'm talking about love, I'm talking about the agape form of love, which is a sacrificial form of love. And the best definition I've ever heard of that is to choose the best interest of another person and act on their behalf. How many times have I chose me rather than the best interest of somebody else? Mm. Too many. And maybe when we leave here today, we would try to see people through the lens of the cross, that is their value and worth, and that is how we should treat them. As valuable as Jesus did when he went to the cross for them. And we wouldn't see them through just trying to be liked. We would see them through choosing to love people. It's important to see people through the lens of the cross, not just what we have in common, not just what we have in like, but what we have in purpose.
Very well said.
Hi guys, thank you so much for watching the Ed Young YouTube channel.
That's right, and if you wanna be inspired, encouraged, and challenged like never before, subscribe and click the notification button.
We believe this channel can help change your life.